Good morning, MBCHB2. Welcome to the lecture for this morning. My name is Susan Odera from the Department of Medical Microbiology. Now, this morning we're going to cover the Neisseriaceae family. This is a group of gram-negative bacteria that are found in the family Neisseriaceae, and we have quite a number of genera in this family: Neisseria, Kingella, Echinella, Aliciella, and others. So the more common group that is commonly encountered as medical pathogens is the Neisseria group. Some like Kingella have emerged recently, but our main focus for this morning will be Neisseria. And we may mention one or two things about others as we go along. So our main focus is Neisseria, and this is how this bacteria looks like. You appreciate that it is a cocci. And we'll begin by looking at some important properties of this genus Neisseria. So one, Neisseria are gram-negative oval cocci that occur in pairs. You can see from this picture on our left, the diplococci. And they're oval in shape. So under the gram staining reaction, in a light microscope, you're going to see the gram-negative oval cocci appearance. You can still appreciate the diplococci of this bacteria. Neisseria is a large genus that colonizes mucosal surfaces of animals. There are three species that colonize animals, other animals, and 11 species have been found to colonize mucosal surfaces in humans. Now, the pathogenic members are the meningococcus and the gonococcus, are found inside polymorphonuclear parcels of the inflammatory exudates. I have a picture to illustrate that. So this is a gram stain of a clinical specimen, and we can see the polymorphonuclear parcels, polymorphonuclear cells, like the neutrophils, and within these cells we can see the diplococci bacteria of Neisseria. So this intracellular location is something that you'd see when you'd make a gram stain from clinical specimen. This can be CSF in the case of meningitis, okay, or discharge, urethral discharge in the case of gonorrhea from a male patient. Another important property is that Neisseria contain endotoxin in their outer membrane. These are gram-negative bacteria, and you recall from your discussion that you had in pathogenicity and virulence factors, the endotoxin is found in gram-negative bacteria. Some small difference in terms of the structural composition: for Neisseria meningitidis, endotoxin is LPS, lipopolysaccharide, while Neisseria gonorrhea, the endotoxin is a lipooligosaccharide. So these bacteria possess the enzyme cytochrome C, which makes them oxidase positive, and all clinically relevant species in this genus are oxidase positive. Now we can identify the species based on carbohydrate utilization. So these different species within the genus Neisseria ferment carbohydrates in a specific fashion, and you can identify the species based on this. Some like Neisseria gonorrhea will ferment glucose only. Some like Neisseria meningitidis will ferment maltose and glucose. So you can set up in the lab different test tubes with different sugars, introduce your unknown species, and based on the carbohydrate utilization pattern, you can identify which species of gonorrhea you are dealing with. Sorry, which species of Neisseria that you're dealing with. Now, both organisms may bear fimbriae. I'm saying this because we have certain strains within a species that are not fimbriated. So the more virulent strains bear numerous fimbriae that contribute in pathogenesis. And from this picture of Neisseria gonorrhea, you can see fimbriae extending from the cell surface. Now, other members of the genus are common commensals of the upper respiratory tract. Okay, remember I had talked about the 11 species that are found on mucosal surfaces in human beings. And this upper respiratory tract is also the reservoir of the meningococcus species. Some of these species include Neisseria lactamica, Neisseria polysaccharae, subflava, Sika, mucosa, etc. It is just important that you remember, besides the two pathogenic species that we are focusing on this morning, there are other species that are found as commensals in the upper respiratory tract. So we are going to begin by looking at Neisseria gonorrhea. Now, according to the World Health Organization, or WHO, WHO has categorized Neisseria gonorrhea as a priority 2 microorganism on the global priority list of antibiotic-resistant bacteria. And based on that classification as a priority 2, this has given emphasis to guide research, discovery, and development of new antibiotics because of the recognition of increasing antimicrobial resistance in gonorrhea infections. Now, no gonococcal vaccine has been identified or rolled out as of now, although a lot of research is going on. So control of the disease relies entirely on prevention, diagnosis, and prompt treatment using antimicrobial agents. The CDC, which is the Centers for Disease Control, has classified Neisseria gonorrhea as a superbug, and this was done in 2012, and actually announced that in the near future, we would have gonorrhea that is untreatable because of the headache of antimicrobial resistance. So Neisseria gonorrhea is exclusively a human pathogen, although in research setups, higher primates like chimpanzees have been infected artificially for purposes of research. It is transmitted sexually, it is an STI. It can also be transmitted during birth from mother to child if the mother has active infection. Now, differences in transmissibility or virulence within the different strains of Neisseria gonorrhea are believed to be accounted for by differences in pili gene expression and surface protein expression of the bacterium. And these would determine the efficiency of adherence onto host cells and evasion of the immune system. So genital tract infections, anorectal, and pharyngeal infections have been documented. So let's look at the virulence factors of Neisseria gonorrhea. Virulence factors include 1, the pili, which mediates attachment to mucosal cell surfaces. Some pili facilitate the twitching motility movement along surfaces, and a lot of gene transfer also takes place in the pili. So the type 4 pili that is found in Neisseria gonorrhea have genes that code for extension and retraction proteins that mediate the twitching motility of the bacteria. This bacteria does not have a flagella, but it has a mode of movement called the twitching motility due to these extension and retraction proteins. The PIL-Q and the PIL-T proteins make the bacteria naturally competent for DNA exchange. Remember when we were discussing bacterial cell genetics, we covered different mechanisms of gene transfer. One of them was transformation. So gene transfer can take place in this bacteria through these PILQ and PILT proteins. Okay, still looking at the virulence factors, we have outer membrane proteins, OPA, that bind to receptors on host immune cells to prevent an immune response and also to prevent establishment of an immunological memory. IgA protease is another important virulence factor that hydrolyzes secretory IgA that is found on mucosal cells or that is secreted on the mucosal cells. Porin A is a protein in the cell wall of the bacteria that inactivates the C3b component of the complement system. So the complement system is an important arm of the immune system that plays a very important role in containing the infection by Neisseria gonorrhoeae. So inactivation of the C3b component of the complement system by this protein, porin A protein, could lead to disseminated gonorrhea disease. Lipooligosaccharide or the endotoxin. Now, some strains of the same species can produce different lipooligosaccharide glycoforms, and modification provides resistance to antimicrobial peptides and complements. So just note that the gonococci species does not have capsule, unlike Neisseria meningitidis, which is a capsulated species in the genus Neisseria. Now, gonococci primarily infect the mucosal surfaces in the urethra and vagina, and certain strains disseminate more than others due to their resistance to being killed by antibodies and complement. Host defenses against gonococci are antibodies IgA and IgG, the complement system, and neutrophils. And persons with a deficiency of the late acting complement components, that is C6 to C9, are at a higher risk for disseminated infections. So what are the clinical manifestations of gonorrhea? And we look at these manifestations in women, in men, and also in babies. So in women, asymptomatic carriage is common. Infection is primarily in the endocervix, causing a purulent vaginal discharge. Gonococci can ascend the fallopian tubules, leading to acute salpingitis, pelvic inflammatory disease, and a high probability of sterility. A complication that can occur is ectopic pregnancies, which can occur as a result of scarring of the tubes. So this patient, this female who is infected, can present with a history of discharge from the vagina, pain or a burning sensation while passing urine, that is dysuria, increased frequency of micturition, increased need to urinate more frequently, heavier periods or spotting, sore throat in the case of pharyngeal infections, pain upon engaging in sexual intercourse, sharp pain in the lower abdomen, and some patients may have fever. Clinical manifestations in men. Okay, the primary presentation in the male patient would be urethritis, and the symptoms are typically purulent or mucopurulent urethral discharge, often accompanied by dysuria. Now, a symptomatic, that is unrecognized infection, may occur in a minority of male cases. A symptomatic gonorrhea may act as a reservoir in the community, and that perpetuates transmission to sexual partners. The incubation period in the male is usually 1 to 14 days for symptomatic disease, but most infected individuals become symptomatic 2 to 5 days after exposure. Complications of gonorrhea in the male patient would include epididymitis, and symptoms would be unilateral testicular pain and swelling. This is infrequent, but it's the most common local complication of gonorrhea infection in males. Other uncommon complications include inguinal lymphadenitis, penile edema, periurethral abscesses or fistula, accessory gland infection, balanitis, urethral strictures, and prostatitis. Pharyngeal infection may be the sole site of infection if oral genital contact is the only exposure. Most often, it is asymptomatic, but symptoms, if present, may include pharyngitis, tonsillitis, fever, and cervical adenitis. Exudative pharyngitis is rare. Babies would present with a condition called ophthalmia neonatorum, which is a severe purulent eye discharge with periorbital edema, and this occurs a few days after birth, a complication that can result from untreated ophthalmia neonatorum is blindness. So this is a picture of a baby with the periorbital edema. This is a baby who has ophthalmia neonatorum, and you can also see here the discharge from the eyes a few days after birth in a baby with ophthalmia neonatorum. Now, dissemination. Disseminated gonorrhea can occur, and peritoneal spread occasionally occurs and may produce perihepatic inflammation. This is a condition called the Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome. Disseminated infection can also present with painful joints, fever, septic lesions on the skin, and rarely endocarditis. So this is a picture of a septic lesion that was found on the skin of a patient who had disseminated gonorrhea. Again, still looking at presentations of disseminated gonorrhea. This is a picture of disseminated gonorrhea arthritis. Now, let us discuss laboratory diagnosis, and this is the basic outline of laboratory diagnosis in bacteriology. 98% of the time, I'm saying 98% of the time because I'm discussing this diagnosis using the Gram stain, but in some instances, when we are processing other clinical specimens or when we are looking at other pathogens, we may pick a different stain. But most of the time, we use the Gram stain. And a discussion of laboratory diagnosis would include laboratory isolation. How do we isolate the pathogen from the clinical specimen? And the second arm would be identification. What do we do to identify the isolate? So we'll begin with specimen collection and transport. If there's need for transport media, that has to be included. Gram stain of the specimen, culture of the specimen into media. Which media do we pick? What are the conditions of culture? After the incubation period, we describe the colonial morphology. Then we gram stain the pure colonies, the isolates, whatever has grown from the clinical specimen on the media. We gram stain it to examine it. Based on this gram stain and colonial morphology, we will carry out certain biochemical tests to identify those isolates. And finally, which is very, very important and useful for management of the patient, you need to carry out an antibiotic susceptibility test to determine which antimicrobial agents can be prescribed for that particular patient. So the specimen of choice, so we'll look at laboratory diagnosis of gonorrhea. Specimen, you can pick urethral swabs. You can take a swab of urethral discharge from a male patient, okay, or cervical exudates from a female. If you cannot take a urethral swab, you can use centrifuged urine from the males. In anorectal infections, you can take a rectal swab. From the babies with eye discharge, you can take an eye swab. And these specimens need to be transported in a media called the Stuart's transport media. Okay? And this would enable you to maintain viability of Neisseria gonorrhea if it is present, so that you can be able to grow it on culture media. So the next step after obtaining your specimen would be to make the first gram stain. And this is an example of the gram stain picture that you'd get. And we can appreciate presence of these polymorphonuclear cells and the gram negative diplococci. Okay, the intracellular location of the gram negative diplococci. So this is the Stuart's transport media that is used for transporting the swabs. The media for culture is chocolate blood agar. And for swabs, high vaginal swabs from the female, we can culture it in thiamatin medium, which is basically chocolate blood agar that has been potentiated with antibiotics, vancomycin, colistin, trimethoprim and nystatin. And the role of these antibiotics is to suppress the normal flora that would possibly be picked when obtaining the specimen from the female patient. Now, the conditions of incubation of the media after inoculation of the specimen, you culture it at 35 to 37 degrees in an atmosphere of increased CO2. So you can use a CO2 jar, and within 18 to 24 hours, you can actually get your colonies on the plate. The next step would be to perform an examination of your colonies. And here you will describe the colonial morphology, a description of the colonies on the media. So Neisseria gonorrhea on chocolate blood agar, a small raised gray translucent colonies. A gram stain of these pure isolates on the media would reveal the gram negative diplococci. Now, you can perform biochemical tests to confirm the identity of this species. It would be positive for the oxidase test. Remember, it produces the enzyme cytochrome C. And carbohydrate utilization tests would indicate fermentation of glucose sugar. Now, we have rapid tests that can be done for quick identification of Neisseria gonorrhea. We have an ELISA kit that can be used to detect gonococcal antigens. We also have a DNA probe assay to detect gonococcal ribosomal genes from clinical specimens. Now, for treatment and control of Neisseria gonorrhea infections, and this is based on WHO STI guidelines, but I want to point out that emphasis should be on local resistance data for dual and single therapy. So you would be guided on which antibiotic to use based on the antimicrobial susceptibility profile test results for that particular isolate from your patient. However, if you're working in an organization where you cannot carry out antimicrobial susceptibility tests or these are not available, you should be guided by the local resistance data. Now, some of the agents that can be used for genital and anorectal gonococcal infections, for dual therapy, you can use ceftriaxone, IM, intramuscular as a single dose, plus azithromycin 1 gram orally as a single dose. This is for dual therapy where you combine ceftriaxone and azithromycin, or you could use cefixime and azithromycin. For the single therapy where you're using one agent, you can use ceftriaxone IM, cefixime orally, 1 dose of 400 milligrams, or spectinomycin 2 grams IM as a single dose. For oral pharyngeal gonococcal infections, it is recommended by WHO to use dual therapy, and this can be ceftriaxone IM as a single dose plus azithromycin orally as a single dose, or cefixime orally as a single dose plus azithromycin orally as a single dose. Now, dual therapy is preferred over single because of reported treatment failure. Now, retreatment after treatment failure and before retreatment is initiated, reinfection should be distinguished from treatment failure. You need to establish that this is a reinfection. This is a new case, okay? A new condition, it is reinvasion of the system, and it is not treatment failure. So it is not failure to treat a primary case. Now, for retreatment after treatment failure, you can use ceftriaxone 500 milligrams IM plus azithromycin 2 grams orally, or cefixime and azithromycin, cefixime 800 milligrams plus azithromycin 2 grams as a single dose, or gentamicin 240 milligrams IM plus azithromycin 2 grams orally, or spectinomycin 2 grams IM as a single dose plus azithromycin 2 grams orally as a single dose. For gonococcal ophthalmia neonatorum, that is in neonates with gonococcal conjunctivitis, you can give ceftriaxone or kanamycin or spectinomycin, and usually these are administered as single doses intramuscularly. For topical ocular prophylaxis in neonates, that is prevention of gonococcal and chlamydial ophthalmia neonatorum, you can use tetracycline hydrochloride 1% eye ointment, erythromycin eye ointment, povidone iodine solution, the water-based one, not the alcohol-based one, silver nitrate 1%, or chloramphenicol 1% eye ointment. Now, three approaches are currently being followed for the development of new therapies against drug-resistant gonococci. One is using novel combinations of already existing antibiotics, that is by using the dual therapy, as I have discussed. Two is development of new antibiotics that look at new target sites on the pathogen. And three is development of alternative therapies which might slow down the appearance of resistance. So prevention of gonorrhea will encompass use of barrier methods like condoms, rapid diagnosis, use of effective antimicrobial agents, and prompt tracing and treatment of patients and their contacts. Just to highlight again, there's a lot of antimicrobial resistance emerging in Neisseria gonorrhea. Okay, penicillin resistance. Penicillin is no longer used because of a lot of resistance, and fluoroquinolone resistance. And here is a study paper that I have included that you can look at, that was looking at the emergence of fluoroquinolone resistance in Neisseria gonorrhea isolates from 4 clinics in 3 different regions in Kenya. Again, this is a recent publication that was done, that was published in 2017, also looking at the resistance pattern, antimicrobial resistance of gonococcal isolates from commercial sex workers from the Sex Workers Outreach Program clinics. The second species we are looking at is Neisseria meningitidis. Now, human beings are the only natural hosts for meningococci, and those human beings who have these bacteria carry this organism in the upper respiratory tract. The bacteria's inability to get iron from other sources other than human transferrin and lactoferrin is possibly the reason why human beings are the only natural hosts. Now, this bacteria causes the only form of bacterial meningitis known to occur epidemically, mainly in Africa and Asia, in the meningococcal belt. Now, carriers are asymptomatic, and studies point out to 5 to 15% of adults being carriers of these bacteria, and the carrier rate is high in people who live in close quarters. So, risk factors for transmission: 1 is close contacts with carriers, 2, a weakened general or local immune response, for example, recent upper respiratory tract infection, this could be from viruses, 3, smoking, and 4, complement deficiency. Now, transmission of this bacteria from carriers to other individuals is by airborne droplets, and studies have shown that it can also spread through saliva and respiratory secretions during coughing, sneezing, kissing, chewing on toys, for example, between children, sharing water bottles, etc. Now, the incubation period is 2 to 10 days. So, from the nasopharynx, the organism can enter the bloodstream and cause systemic infection and spread to specific sites, more significantly the meninges, joints, or throughout the body once meningococcemia occurs. So we are going to look at the virulence factors of the pathogen Neisseria meningitidis, and just to note that Neisseria meningitidis ranks second to Streptococcus pneumoniae as a cause of meningitis, okay, bacterial meningitis. An important virulence factor of the meningococci is the polysaccharide capsule, which enables the bacteria to resist phagocytosis by polymorphonuclear leukocytes. The capsule protects against soluble immune effector mechanisms in serum. The capsular antigen defines the serologic group. So we have several serotypes found in the species, or different serologic groups, and these serogroups are identified based on the capsular antigen. These capsular antigens are also detected in the spinal fluid of patients, so rapid diagnosis can be done by detection of the polysaccharide capsular antigen, and it is also the antigen that is used in preparation of the vaccine. Still looking at virulence factors, pili and surface proteins OPA and OPC that would facilitate attachment to cells. 3, the endotoxin, LPS, which causes fever, shock, and disseminated intravascular coagulation, DIC. Immunoglobulin A, IgA protease, is an enzyme that is secreted by these bacteria, and it cleaves secretory IgA, the IgA that you'd find on the mucosal cells. Once this happens, it enables the bacteria to attach to membranes in the upper respiratory tract. So the immune response from the infected host. Resistance to disease correlates with presence of antibody to the capsular polysaccharide. Immunity is serogroup specific because the antibodies are going to recognize the capsular antigens. Now, people with complement deficiencies have increased incidence of meningococcal bacteremia. Serogroup of meningococcus is determined by its capsular lipopolysaccharide capsular antigen. I have mentioned that. And you can identify these serogroups by slide agglutination with absorbed group-specific antisera. Examples of serogroups that have been identified include A, B, C, all the way to Z. And you can see we give them alphabetical letters. We name them using alphabetical letters. These serogroups vary in terms of geographical distributions. You'll find that certain serogroups are more prevalent in certain continents. Okay? But we name them A, B, C. Some are associated with comorbidities like Z and E causes disease in patients with underlying disease. So these are some examples of serogroups that have been identified, and they are based on the capsular antigens. Now, clinical manifestations. Just know that meningitis, and in this case bacterial meningitis, is a medical emergency. So suspicion of meningitis is a medical emergency, and this patient needs to be treated urgently. It is important that you treat or you manage suspect cases pending laboratory results. So conclusive lab results can be obtained after culture of the clinical specimen, but that would take some time. As you wait for those results, if you do not have rapid tests, you need to manage or treat these suspected cases. Reduced ability to identify the bacteria is outweighed by reduced chance of death. And based on this, we can initiate empirical antimicrobial therapy immediately pending conclusive laboratory investigations. And this is based on the age and the condition of the patient. If the patient has an underlying condition and the age. So for 0 to 4 weeks, the neonates, we can use ampicillin and cefotaxime or aminoglycosides for empiric therapy. 4 to 12 weeks, ampicillin and ceftriaxone. For 3 months to 18 years, cefotaxime or ceftriaxone. For 18 years to 50 years, cefotaxime or ceftriaxone. And for more than 50 years, we can use ampicillin and cefotaxime or ceftriaxone. For the immunocompromised patient, you can. Now, there are two important clinical manifestations in infection with Neisseria meningitidis. One, of course, is meningitis, and the patient will present with fever, headache, stiff neck, and increased polymorphonuclear cells in the spinal fluid. So the CSF specimen is going to be turbid because of the parcels. Meningococcemia is another clinical manifestation. And typically, patients with meningococcemia present with a purpuric rash, that is a non-blanching rash. It has a high mortality rate of up to 50%. Massive bilateral hemorrhage into adrenal glands caused by fulminant meningococcemia. Disseminated intravascular coagulation, thrombocytopenia, and adrenal insufficiency are some of the clinical syndromes that you'd see in a patient with meningococcemia. This syndrome is called the Waterhouse-Fredrickson syndrome. So this is a picture of the purpuric or the non-blanching rash in meningococcemia. Another picture showing you the rash in meningococcemia. So for laboratory diagnosis of meningococcal meningitis, we are going to use the same outline that we used in lab diagnosis: specimen collection and transport, gram stain from specimen, culture of the specimen in routine lab media, description of the colonial morphology after incubation of the cultured specimen, gram stain of the colony or the isolates that grow after incubation, and then biochemical tests to identify the isolates, and finally antimicrobial susceptibility tests on the clinical isolates. So the specimen of choice for lab diagnosis would be blood in a case of meningococcemia, cerebrospinal fluid in a suspected case of meningitis, and you can also pick specimen from disseminated sites in case of disseminated infection. Now, gram stain of the specimen, you'd centrifuge your CSF specimen and gram stain the centrifuge deposit, or the deposit obtained after centrifugation, and what you'll be able to see are the gram negative diplococci inside polymorphonuclear cells. You can culture your specimen in blood culture bottles for the blood specimen, and then subculture onto your CBA after you have obtained growth from the blood culture bottles. You can culture the CSF directly into chocolate blood agar. Incubate at 35 to 37 degrees for a duration of 18 to 24 hours in an increased CO2 atmosphere. So these media plates can be put in a CO2 jar for the increased CO2 atmosphere. This is a picture showing you the Castaneda blood culture bottles used to culture the blood specimen. And once you have some growth in the blood culture bottles, you subculture into the chocolate blood agar. This is the CO2 jar that is used to incubate the plates. So you put the plates inside the jar, you light the candle, and then you cover it. And once the oxygen is depleted, there's going to be the increased CO2 atmosphere. So this is how a culture plate of Neisseria meningitidis looks like on chocolate blood agar. And you'll be able to see this once you have some practical sessions, once we resume. From the culture plate, you prepare a gram stain, okay? And you'll be able to see this gram negative diplococci. Biochemical tests to identify the isolate would include oxidase test, and this is what you'd see. It is rapidly oxidase positive. And sugar fermentation tests, these species ferments glucose and maltose. So we have other tests that are available, okay, for rapid diagnosis. And most of these tests are based on identification of the meningococcal capsular polysaccharide. These are countercurrent electrophoresis, latex agglutination, and molecular tests that utilize the polymerase chain reaction techniques. Now for treatment, we can use third generation cephalosporins like cefotaxime and ceftriaxone. For prevention, we can use chemoprophylaxis approach, and this has been used to control outbreaks of the disease by eradicating the organism from carriers. So recent contacts of infected patients, young children, child caregivers, direct exposure to patients through kissing, sharing utensils, mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, etc. These are individuals who would receive this agent, oral rifampicin, for chemoprophylaxis. Now we have vaccines that can be used to prevent meningococcal meningitis or meningococcal infection. And these vaccines contain the pure group-specific capsular polysaccharide. Vaccines for meningococcal groups of serogroups A, C, Y and W are available, and they are very, very good immunogens. Now remember that protection provided by each vaccine is serogroup specific. Now just to point out to you that in 2010, there's a meningitis vaccine project in the African meningitis belt that was launched by the Serum Institute of India, and it began in Burkina Faso in 2010, where several people in the general population were given this vaccine against serogroup A, and it has been very, very useful in minimizing outbreaks of meningococcal meningitis. There is always a periodic outbreak or an epidemic from the meningococcal meningitis, meningococcal bacteria along the meningitis belt. So this vaccine project that was launched by MenAfricVac has been useful, and it was rolled out in several countries in West Africa, cutting across the meningitis belt. So So for prevention, chemoprophylaxis and vaccines can be used. So we are going to look at this genus Moraxella or Branhamella in briefly. And this was named after a Swiss ophthalmologist called Victor Morax. Some of the species in the genus Branhamella have been reclassified into Moraxella. Okay. So this organism, it's a rare agent of infection. Most species in the genus Moraxella or Branhamella are generally considered not to be of high pathogenicity. It is aerobic and it has both a fermentative and respiratory type of metabolism. No acid is produced from glucose and other carbohydrates. So some of the identified species in this genus have been listed here, but the most common one would be Moraxella catarrhalis. You can see previously it was called Branhamella catarrhalis. And the other common one is Moraxella nonliquefaciens. So looking at some of the biological characteristics of this organism, it is gram negative with a tendency to resist discoloration. Morphologically, they are short, plump rods, frequently approaching a coccus shape. So they are short and plump, frequently approaching a coccus shape, and they occur in pairs or short chains. They are 1.0 to 1.5 micrometers by 1.5 to 2.5 micrometers. Swimming motility is absent because they do not have a flagella, but surface-bound twitching motility may be present. Some encapsulation occurs within certain species, and these are non-spore-forming bacteria. So for culture, these organisms grow on nutrient agar, blood agar, tryptose blood agar, and chocolate agar, and the conditions for culture would be 30 to 37 degrees. You can isolate them in 24 to 48 hours. And they can grow in an aerobic atmosphere with or without increased CO2 on media that has a pH of 5 to 9. The colonial morphology, the colonies appear smooth, translucent, and semi-opaque. Now, Moraxella catarrhalis is the major pathogen in this genus. It is only found in humans and is transmitted by respiratory aerosols. Now, this bacteria is an upper respiratory tract commensal, but it can gain access to the lower respiratory tract in patients with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease or patients who have an impaired ciliary motion. It has been implicated in otitis media and sinusitis, primarily in children. So for laboratory diagnosis, you can make a gram film from sputum specimen or a bronchoalveolar lavage specimen from the patient. And from this gram film, you'll be able to see large numbers of gram-negative diplococci dispersed between parcels. The sputum can be cultured on BA or CBA or the other media that we mentioned, incubated in 5% CO2 atmosphere overnight. For the biochemical test, it is butyrate esterase positive and it's also deoxyribonuclease positive. For treatment, we can use trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole or potentiated amoxicillin clavulanate. The other important species is Moraxella nonliquefaciens, which is one of the two common causes of blepharitis, that is eyelid infection, commonly called styes. The other agent that commonly causes eyelid infection is Staphylococcus aureus. And for this, Treatment is local application of topical antimicrobial agents like erythromycin ointment. Thank you for your time. I hope this presentation will guide you. I will share this presentation with you. I will share the notes, and I will also share two publications that you would read through as you wait to have the practical session at a later date. Thank you.